Welcome to another video. For those of you who don't know me, I'm Dr. Mike Hansen, board certified in internal medicine, pulmonary disease, and critical care medicine. And I'm guessing if you're watching this video, it's because you only want the best for your child. So should you give your child the Pfizer COVID vaccine? Before drawing a conclusion, we first need to answer some very important questions. So in this video, I'm gonna break down the risks and the benefits of giving your child the new Pfizer COVID vaccine, which now has EUA emergency use authorization for children age 5 to 11, and it's 1/3 of the dose of the adult version. And by the end of this video, I'll give you my final take and answer the question, would I give it to my own child? Do I have children? But before we can understand the risks and benefits of the vaccine, we first have to understand the risks that come with COVID in children in the age group 5 to 11. In the United States, children less than 18 years account for about 15% of lab-confirmed cases reported to the CDC. And that's likely an underestimation given the high proportion of mild and asymptomatic cases that never get tested. Children of all ages can get COVID, but the incidence does increase with age. The most recent CDC data from September of 2021 shows that 38% of children in the 5 to 11 age group have COVID antibodies, indicating that they've had previous COVID infection. When children get sick with COVID, the symptom breakdown usually involves pneumonia-type symptoms like fever, cough, and shortness of breath. In general, COVID is milder in children compared to adults, but severe cases do occur. COVID hospitalizations in children less than 18 peaked in January of 2021, declined when you get to June, and then it picked back up again and had a second really big surge with the Delta variant starting in July. Overall, there have been more than 8,300 children ages 5 to 11 hospitalized with COVID, and more than 2,300 have gotten the related MISC. MISC refers to system-wide inflammation in the body. It's a condition that is similar to Kawasaki disease. In a study that looked at over 1,000 children hospitalized with MISC, the most common age group was between age 6 to 12. COVID infection in children is associated with an increased risk of myocarditis, but the absolute risk is low, less than 0.15%. Other cardiovascular issues can occur as well, such as pericarditis, arrhythmias, and heart failure. But overall, these are still pretty rare. Now, in a multi-center case series of 1,700 children hospitalized with COVID, 1/3 of which had MISC, overall, 22% had neurological symptoms. Most of them were only temporary. Now, in that study, 43 had severe neurologic involvement, and this included things like stroke, Guillain-Barré syndrome, and severe seizures, meaning they're referring to status epilepticus. Now, overall, 11 children in that study died. In a systematic review that saw information of about 1,500 children, 2% had severe pneumonia, and 0.7% required a ventilator, with 6 of those children dying. We do know that children with underlying conditions who get COVID have a higher rate of hospitalization and ICU admission, and the most common underlying medical conditions associated with higher risk of hospitalization are obesity, chronic pulmonary disease, such as asthma, and those who were premature babies. In another study that involved several countries, the COVID death rate was 0.17 per 100,000 children. In the United States, according to the CDC, 745 children under the age of 18 years have died of COVID, but in the 5 to 11 group specifically, it's 172 deaths. So overall, the chances that a child will have severe COVID, require hospitalization, or develop a long-term complication like MISC, overall it's very low, but it's still a risk. And it is a risk that is higher for many other diseases that we vaccinate children for. For example, we give children the influenza vaccine, even though the risk of a child having a bad outcome from influenza is relatively small, but not insignificant. So with COVID, based on the numbers, the vaccine has the potential to save more than 700 kids' lives per year. And that's not to mention all the other benefits that come with the vaccine. So that's including preventing hospitalization and allowing kids to go to school without having to wear masks, and letting kids just be kids to improve their social and mental well-being. And also, vaccinating 28 million kids age 5 to 11 will get us one step closer to herd immunity. Why? because with new variants, for example with Delta, the number of children being infected is increasing. If you have a higher percentage of the population that is unvaccinated, including children, the more you end up perpetuating this cycle of infection. And this leads to new, potentially more dangerous variants emerging. And the reality is, practically speaking, it's going to be impossible to get herd immunity without getting children vaccinated. But of course, we first have to know if the vaccine is safe in this age group, age 5 to 11. One thing to know right off the bat is that this dose of the vaccine is one-third the dose that was used in Pfizer's other studies, including the one used in adults in the very beginning, but also the one used for adolescents. Pfizer's trial in this age group of 5 to 11 originally involved 2,268 children. Two-thirds of the participants received two doses of the vaccine 3 weeks apart. The other third received a placebo that contained saline. According to Pfizer's data for this group, the vaccine was 90.7% effective in preventing symptomatic COVID, and the ones who got the vaccine experienced a robust mounting of antibodies similar to the level seen in vaccinated 16 to 25-year-olds. In July, federal regulators asked Pfizer, and Moderna for that matter, to expand their trial sizes for this age group as a precautionary step to better detect any rare side effects from the vaccine. The more numbers you have, the more reliable the results. So Pfizer increased its study to about 4,500 children. The additional children in the study were studied for a shorter amount of time. Now, despite that, Pfizer says the vaccine is safe and well-tolerated in all of the children, with zero cases of severe illness and zero cases of myocarditis. The FDA then took a look at the data, and their conclusion was that the benefits of preventing severe cases of COVID outweighed the risks of possible side effects. And what about that myocarditis, meaning inflammation of the heart muscle? It's a medical condition that existed long before COVID, and it can cause chest pain and shortness of breath. In any given week, there are two cases of myocarditis for every million people, so incredibly rare. The risk for myocarditis does jump to 50 cases per million vaccine doses given in a certain age group of boys, and that's 12 to 24 years of age. And according to the CDC, even in that age group, 12 to 24, there are zero deaths attributed to myocarditis. So the slightly higher risk of myocarditis should not deter them from getting the vaccine because one, it's still very rare in those circumstances. And two, the risk of myocarditis is higher after COVID infection compared to vaccine. And when it comes to younger children, that risk is even lower. Also, that smaller dose of the vaccine is expected to further minimize that risk. And based on Pfizer's data for the 5 to 11 age group in this most recent study, there were zero cases of myocarditis or pericarditis. The side effects for children from this clinical trial are comparable to those from the adolescent study. Now, according to the FDA, if side effects did occur after the vaccine, the most common ones in the adolescent trial were pain at the injection site, fatigue, headache, chills, muscle pain, fever, and joint pain. So if those adolescents did have side effects come up, they generally were gone within 1 to 3 days. Now you take that and you compare that with the data from the age 5 to 11 group. And it was basically more of the same, except the side effects occurred much less frequently and were generally milder. For example, fever was a side effect at a rate of 6.5% compared to 17% of the 16 to 25 year group. It's also important to note that allergies to Pfizer's vaccine ingredients like polyethylene glycol, very rare. The vaccine does not contain eggs, preservatives, or latex. As of the making of this video, 191 million Americans are fully vaccinated, the vast majority with the mRNA vaccines Pfizer and Moderna. This includes adolescents and the millions of doses given in that age group. The vaccines have been under the most intense safety monitoring ever, and we can say for certain that the vaccine is very safe and very effective. And based on the Pfizer data for ages 5 to 11, they're safe for that age group as well. Although COVID vaccines are new, the mRNA technology for them is not, as they've been studied for about 15 years. just like water, our bodies naturally contain mRNA molecules. And the mRNA molecules from the vaccine are destroyed and don't linger in our body. So based on that, scientists and medical experts have zero reason to believe that they're not safe for our growing bodies and would not have an impact on puberty, fertility, or brain development. The FDA and CDC have not yet weighed in on this matter for this age group. But for ages 12 and up, the CDC says it's safe to get the flu and other vaccines at the same time as the COVID vaccine, saying the side effects are generally the same when they're either given alone or in combination together. Yes, the safety database size for this age group is actually considered to be on the higher end in terms of numbers. The FDA has actually supported licensure for other vaccines that had smaller numbers in those studies. Right now, this is still to be determined and would likely come down to a discussion with you and your child's pediatrician. Now, overall, the risk of reinfection in children appears to be low, and that's based on a review of 172 children who had COVID. Only 4 of them had reinfection 1 to 3 weeks after they had a negative test. With that said, we know that in adults, that COVID infection doesn't generate the same level of immunity compared to the vaccines. So, would I give this vaccine to my children if I had children, age 5 to 11? I would, and I'd feel very comfortable doing so. When I went to college, I majored in biology with a minor in biochemistry, then 4 years in med school and 12 years as a practicing physician. So I understand the science. I understand mRNA molecules, vaccines, and immunology, and I understand scientific literature. That's why I was very comfortable getting the vaccine when it first came out in December of last year. Seeing what I'm seeing with the best data that we have available, I would not hesitate to vaccinate my child. Regardless, my recommendation for you is to speak to your child's pediatrician. That way you can do what's best for your child.